दिस इज खाजा आसिफुल्ला, हेलो, दिस इज खाजा आसिफुल्ला फ्रॉम गवर्नमेंट डिग्री कॉलेज फलकनुमा हैदराबाद। टुडे वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट पार्ट फिफ्थ ऑफ एटॉमिक स्ट्रक्चर फ्रॉम केमिस्ट्री। एक्चुअली दिस इज द फिफ्थ लेसन। Before this, we have four lessons, so it is a part fifth or fifth lesson. In this, mainly we have to discuss about the quantum numbers, their significance and importance. Actually, we have to discuss about the fine spectrum of atom. Bohr could not explain the hydrogen spectrum in which he observed spectral lines and also the splitting of these spectral lines under the influence of magnetic field called as Zeeman effect and electric field called as Stark effect, which indicates the possibility of many energy changes inside the atom. But this is possible only when there are sub energy levels available in an atom in which electron can reside beside the Bohr's circular orbit. Also, there are a number of orbitals available in an atom in which electron can accommodate. The solution for the Schrödinger wave equation give set of three quantum numbers, namely principal quantum number, n azimuthal quantum number, l magnetic quantum number, m. But to identify a particular electron in an atom, we require four quantum numbers. The fourth quantum number, called as spin quantum number S, is actually the result of the spin of electrons on their own axis. It is not the result of solution of Schrödinger wave equation, but it arises due to the spin of electrons on their own axis. Before we deal with quantum numbers in detail, let us first take orbital. What is orbital? It is nothing but the space around the nucleus where there is probability of finding an electron or probability of finding electron density. Every orbital can accommodate not more than two electrons. Means the electron may or may not be present in an orbital. If there is no electron, it is empty orbital. If there is one electron, it is half filled, and two electrons completely filled. When there are two electrons, as we know, they spin on their own axis, but they will have opposite spin, or the spin of electron is in opposite direction. If one spin in clockwise, direction, the other will spin in anti-clockwise direction. With this brief introduction or recall of our previous knowledge, now we can take in detail the quantum numbers. Let us first take the principal quantum number. The main points to remember and to understand about it are, first, it was proposed by Bohr. If you remember, in Bohr's theory, he says that electrons revolve around the nucleus of an atom in definite circular orbits, and he denotes those orbits as n, and those orbits can also be called as main energy levels or energy shells. And n here can have values, n number of values, and starting from 1, 2, 3, etc., etc., up to infinity. But the elements which are known to us, the 7 to 8 values for n are sufficient. That means for today, n can have values from 1 to 7 or 8, not more than that. It is sufficient. Then this can also be designated by K, L, M, N, etc. So the main energy levels are designated by K, L, M, N. K means first orbit or first main energy level. L, second main energy level or energy shell, like that. This gives, or this picture gives you a clear idea about the Bohr's model and where from the quantum number n, or principal quantum number n, comes from. From Rutherford we had nucleus, from Bohr orbits. These are designated orbits which are called stationary orbit because the electron revolving around the nucleus in these particular orbits do not radiate energy. Means as long as a particular electron revolves around the nucleus in a particular orbit, say first orbit, then it will not radiate or lose or gain energy. If it do so, it will jump from lower to higher orbit or from higher to lower orbit. So this is first energy level, n is equal to 1 or k. Second shell, n is equal to 2 or l, m, and etc. So the above figure illustrates this, that n, principal quantum number, gives energy shells, and it determines the size of energy, size of main energy level, and also again you consider this figure. First orbit is smaller one, then second, then third, then fourth. Here the n, that is principal quantum number, will give you the size of orbit and also the energy of orbit. What is the meaning of size of orbit? It may have only one sub energy level. Second, two sub energy levels. In this way, the orbits or main energy levels will become bigger in size as we move to outer side. So first orbit is small and will have least value. Second, higher value for energy, and size is bigger than first. And the last one will have highest energy and biggest orbit. So you have to remember in that way. Now, as the value of n increases, both size and size and energy of main energy levels increases. As I just now explained you, from first orbit to last orbit, the size as well as energy increases. Now, you know that from the beginning of atomic theories, the atom is considered as a sphere. So the size of a sphere depends on its radius. Only one parameter on which the size of atom depends, that is radius of atom. And this radius is actually depends upon the number of orbits which are present in the atom. If in an atom only one orbit is there, like in the case of hydrogen, then the radius will be from the center of nucleus to the first orbit. The distance between center of nucleus to first orbit is called radius of atom for hydrogen. For helium also, for lithium, second orbit in this way up to neon, then third orbit, fourth orbit. So the radius of atom is nothing but the distance between the center of nucleus to the last orbit which is present in that atom. And also we have to consider the radius of a particular orbit, first orbit from this center to this point, second orbit center to this point, like that. So this we can calculate is the radius of an orbit or an atom of a particular element can be calculated with the formula, which is given as Rn means radius of first, n means 1, 2, 3 again. It can have values 1, 2, 3, etc. R1 means radius of first orbit. R2 means radius of second orbit, like that. Is given by n square h square divided by 4 pi E square mz. Here n is the value of principal quantum number 1, 2, 3, etc. H is Planck's constant. M, mass of the electron. E, charge of the electron. And Z is atomic number of the atom of the particular element whose radius we are calculating. Now, except for N and Z, whose value change, that means it's are not constant, all other are constant. For example, E, M are charge and mass of the electron is constant, H Planck's constant. Therefore, the value of R, N depends only on the values of N and Z. That is, N is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. First orbit, radius of first orbit, second orbit, etc. And Z means atomic number. So, keeping them as it is, if you substitute the values of M, E, H, and Pi, Planck's constant, mass, charge of electron, and the value of Pi, then we get Rn as equal to N square into 0.529 divided by Z angstrom. So if we know for which orbit we are trying to find or calculate the radius and what is the Z, then we can calculate the radius of atom or radius of a particular orbit of an atom. For example, if we take hydrogen atom, we know that in hydrogen only one orbit is there, for helium also. But for hydrogen we have to substitute that as, we have to take that as 1, for helium 2, like that. For n is equal to 1, we get the radius of first orbit. For n is equal to 2, we get the radius of second orbit. Now, to calculate the radius of hydrogen atom, both n and z are taken as 1, because z, that is atomic number of hydrogen, is 1, and there is only one orbit, or first energy level. So in that way, if you substitute 1 for this, 1 square means 1, divided by 1 means 1, 1 into this means the same value. So the radius of first orbit of hydrogen will be equal to 0.529 angstrom. Luckily, there is only one orbit in hydrogen, therefore it is nothing but the radius of hydrogen atom. It is also called as Bohr's radius, or radius of Bohr's orbit. Why? Because in hydrogen there is only one orbit, and that will be circular orbit, and it was proposed by Bohr, therefore it is called Bohr's orbit. So the radius of Bohr's orbit is 0.529 angstrom, and 1 angstrom is equal to 10 to the power minus 8 centimeter. Therefore, radius of Bohr's orbit will be 0.529 into 10 to the power minus 8 centimeters, or it is also a radius of hydrogen. And as I told you just now, also determines energy of electron present in a particular orbit. You should recall that energy of electron depends upon on the orbit in which it is present. Whether it is present in first orbit or in second orbit or in third, like that. Why? Because the energy of every orbit is different. And I told you just now that the energy of orbit decreases from first orbit to last orbit. The other meaning is the first orbit of an atom will have least energy, and the outermost or last orbit will have highest energy. So it depends upon the orbit in which it is present. Second thing, inside a particular orbit or energy shell, there can be sub-energy shells or sub-energy levels, on which also the energy of electron depends, because every sub-shell will have its own value for energy, or no two sub-shells will have same energy. So we have to consider this formula to calculate the energy of nth orbit. We had formula to find the radius of nth orbit, similarly energy of nth orbit. En is equal to 2 pi square m e to the power 4 z square, whole divided by n square h square. That means energy of nth orbit is given by 2 pi square m e to the power 4 z square by n square h square. Again, the values are like this. N is principal quantum number and can have values from 1, 2, 3, etc. M and E are charge and mass of electron. M means mass of electron, E is charge of electron. H, Planck's constant, Z again is atomic number of a particular element. Again, if we see here, N and M can vary. That means the values of N and M can vary, whereas the values of H, M, E, and pi are constant. So if you substitute those values or values of those, we get the energy of nth orbit as equal to minus 1312 pi n square kilojoules per mole minus 1312 by n square kilojoules per mole. But you know there is only one orbiting hydrogen atom in which electron is present. There may be orbits more than one, that means second, third, etc., but they are empty. All other energy levels in hydrogen atoms are empty. First orbit. So energy of first orbit will be minus 1312 by 1 square, or 1 square means 1, 1 divided by this one. Again, the same number. That is, the energy of first orbit of hydrogen is minus 1312 kilojoules per mole. This is the energy of electron which is present in hydrogen and first orbit of hydrogen atom. Now, the same energy with opposite sign is required to give to electron so that it is removed from electron the atom. Therefore, plus 1312 kilojoules per mole is the energy required to remove those electrons from hydrogen atom, or it is also called as ionization energy or ionization potential of hydrogen. Here, negative sign refers that electron has this much energy, and if we calculate the energy of second orbit, third orbit, the number will become smaller. You have to remember that the number will become smaller, but this number is with minus sign. So the minus sign means as the number decreases, the value increases, or as the number increases, the value decreases. So again, we can say that the first orbit will have least energy, or energy of first orbit is least, energy of last orbit is highest. For example, if we take atom of an element in which four energy states are there, or four main energy levels are there, or four orbits are there, then the fourth orbit or fourth energy level will have highest energy, and the first one will have least, and the order will be E4 is greater than E3 is greater than E2 is greater than E1. A reverse order we can write: E1 is less than, E2 is less than, E3 is less than E4. Now, let us consider the second quantum number called as azimuthal quantum number. It is also called as subsidiary or angular momentum quantum number, and it is denoted by L. This quantum number was proposed by Sommerfeld. Sommerfeld proposed azimuthal quantum number. He denoted it by letter K. Later on, it was changed to L. Now, why he gave this, or why he proposed this? Because according to Sommerfeld theory of atom, or Sommerfeld model of atom, beside Bohr's circular orbit in an atom around the nucleus, there are elliptical orbits too, in which electrons can revolve around the nucleus. If it is the nucleus of an atom, and if these are main energy levels. Circular orbits are main energy levels. Then these are sub energy levels. And this picture illustrates about the orbit which is given by n is equal to 4 or nth orbit, n orbit, capital N. And in n is equal to 4 means fourth orbit or fourth main energy level. In fourth orbit, totally 4 sub energy levels will be there. One will be a circular one, which is Bohr's orbit. The other are elliptical in shape. Now, these are denoted by K. This circular orbit will have value K is equal to 0. Then K is equal to 1. Then K is equal to 2. This is K is equal to 2 power N is equal to 4. And this is K is equal to, in this way, we have K values from 1 to 4. Platon, it was changed by L. Now L is called azimuthal quantum number. So L can have values from 0 to n minus 1, but the total number of values will be equal to n, value of n. As I told you just now, in which we have taken one example in which n was equal to 4. Therefore, L can have 4 values starting from 0. Then n set n minus 1 means 0, 1, 2, and 3. Why? Because n is 4. 4 minus 1 is 3. So 4 values of our L when n is equal to 4 are 0, 1, 2, and 3. So you have to remember that the values of L will be equal to n, or it will have n values, but start from 0 and ends at n minus 1. Or sometimes we say this is the minimum value for L, which is 0, and the highest value for L, that is n minus 1. Now to explain fine structure, Sommerfeld proposed these elliptical orbits, which are actually nothing but sub-energy levels or sub-orbits. So inside the main energy level, these are the sub-energy levels. Now you can say that when n is equal to 1, that is for first orbit, L will have only one value, and that will be 0. So L is equal to 0 means only one orbit, that is circular orbit. For second orbit, which will be given by n is equal to 2, L can have 2 values. What will be the values? 0 and 1. 2 minus 1 means 1. Therefore, one orbit will be circular and one will be elliptical in shape. And both will represent the subshell, sub-energy levels. For n is equal to 3, 3 subshells, 1 circular, 2 elliptical. In this way, for n is equal to 4, these many, 1 circular and 3 elliptical. Now, these subshells are denoted by S, P, D, and F. Okay? If L is having value 0, then it is called S sub level. L is equal to 0 means S sub level. If it is 1, then it is called P sub level. Because in first orbit, only one subshell will be there, it will be only S subshell. And in second orbit, 2 sublevels, one is S, another is P. For n is equal to 3, 3 subshells, L is equal to 0, 1, 2, 3. So in M shell, our third shell, we will be having S, P, and D sub levels. For N is equal to 4, which just now we have seen in the figure, this is S sub shell, P, D, and F. This will give you clear idea. For N is equal to 1, only one orbit. This is the nucleus around which only one orbit is shown. This is circular and this is Bohr's orbit. Now N is equal to 2, two subshells. One is circular, that is Bohr's, and the other is elliptical. For N is equal to 3, one is circular, two elliptical. And for N is equal to 4, this will be the figure. Gives you an idea. Actually, with the naked eye, we cannot see atom, then electron, and the sublevels or main energy levels are also not seen. But you can imagine that this will be like this, or the atomic structure you have to imagine. Now, what knowledge or information we can get from azimuthal quantum number or subsidiary or magnitude. This quantum number L determines the shape of subshell. For example, if we take S subshell, what will be the shape? We'll have spherically symmetrical or symmetrically spherical. As we discussed in earlier class, the shapes are the result of solution of psi square. When wave function or wave equation is solved for certain values, we get radial problem values for psi square, and when we plot the values of psi square versus the radius or the distance from the center of nucleus, then there will be distribution of electron density or probability of finding an electron on the basis of those curves, which are called radial probability curves. We can say the shape of a particular orbit is like this. So here S sublevel will have spherical and P will have dumbbell shape, D will have double dumbbell shape, and for F it is very complex. Now then L will give you an idea about the size of subshell also. How many orbitals will be there? How many electrons it can accommodate, like that. As you know, for N is equal to 1, L will be having only one value, that is 0, and there will be only one subshell, and in one subshell there will be one orbital, and in one orbital there can be two electrons. But how we get it? Actually, this is the formula, 2 into 2L plus 1, where if we substitute the value of L as 0 for S sublevel, subshell, we get the value. L is equal to 0 means 2 into 0 plus 1. 0 plus 1 means 1, 1 into 2, 2 means the capacity or the size of S subshell is 2 electron, means it is very small compared to the other subshells. Why? Because if we consider L is equal to 1, L is equal to 1 means P subshell. If we substitute L is equal to 1, 2 into 1, plus 1, 3, 3 into 2, 6 electrons. electrons. That is, here three orbitals will be there. In p sublevel, there will be three p orbitals. Each will contain, or each can accommodate two electrons. 3 × 2, 6 electrons totally. A p subshell can accommodate, or it is bigger in size than s orbital. So s is the smallest one, and the size increases from s to f. Now, next one, where l will be having value 2, and l is equal to 2 in d sublevel. And if you substitute l is equal to 2 in the above formula, where 2 × 2, L plus 1 is the formula. L is equal to 2 means 2 × 2, 4 + 1, 5. Means 5 orbitals will be there in D sublevel, and every orbital will have 2 electrons. Totally, there will be 10 electrons. 2 × 2 + 1, 5 orbitals. Each orbital having 2 electrons. 5 × 10. In F, L is 3. The other meaning is, when L has value 3, we call it as F sublevel. And if you substitute 3 in place of L, we get 2 × 3, 6 + 1, 7. 7 orbitals in F sublevel will be there, and 2 electrons each means 14 electrons. In this way, the first orbit will have 2 electrons. Second orbit can have 8 electrons, third orbit 18 electrons, and fourth orbit 32 electrons. But it is not always true for lower elements. Here in M shell, D orbital will be empty, or D subshell will be completely empty. As a result, again, there will be a chance of only 8 electrons. And here, 14 electrons will not be there, or F orbital will be empty. Therefore, 32 − 14 = 18 electrons. Why? Because these will be filled later in higher elements. Therefore, in general, in first orbit, we have 2 electrons. In second, 8 electrons. In third, 18. And fourth, 32. In this way, number of electrons increases. Now, if you consider this figure illustrates about the above thing. First orbit, this is the picture or structure of atom. This part is called nucleus. This is first orbit. This is second orbit, third orbit. And you know, orbits can also be called as energy shells or energy levels. Now in this one, we have only 2 electrons. Why? Because this is first orbit having only 1 s orbital, because it has only 1 sublevel, that is s sublevel. So it can accommodate not more than 2 electrons. When we come to second orbit, it will become bigger in size, as well as it will possess more energy. It will have 2 sublevels, S and P. And in S level, only 1 orbital, so 2 electrons. In P sublevel, 3 orbitals. Every orbital can contain or accommodate 2 electrons. 2 + 2 + 2 = 6. 6 + 2 = 8 electrons in total in second orbit. Coming to third, D sublevel will be added to this because it is bigger in size than second. So as size increases, it can have 3 sublevels, namely S, P, and D. Therefore, in S, 2 electrons. In P, 2 + 2 + 2, 6 electrons. In D, 10 electrons totally. 10 plus 6 plus 2 means 18 electrons. If you imagine that there is a one more or fourth orbit, then we will be having four subshells, S, P, D, and F. Up to D, we have 18 electrons, and in F sublevel, there will be seven orbitals. Every orbital can have two electrons, 7 into 10, 14 electrons, therefore 14 in F sublevel, and 18 in S, P, and D. And the total will be 18 plus 14 means 32. It is just like this. So it is 2, then 8, then 18, then 32. Okay. Now we have magnetic quantum number. Magnetic quantum number, again, is a quantum number which gives you orbitals. This is also arises due to the solution of Schrödinger wave equation. As I told you earlier, when we solve Schrödinger wave equation, these three quantum number arises, N, L, and M. This is the third one, which is due to solution of Schrödinger wave equation. Now, it is proposed by Landé. Its symbol is M, and it can have 2L plus 1 values, and this give you orbitals, number of orbitals in a particular sublevels. This part of this is discussed in the previous part of the lesson when we were discussing about the azimuthal quantum number L. Now, if you take again, M represent magnetic quantum number, and it can have 2L plus 1 values. What is L? Azimuthal quantum number, and hence we have to substitute the value of azimuthal quantum number. And if we recall, azimuthal quantum number can have values from 0 to n minus 1. So first one is 0. When we substitute 0, 0 into 2 is 0, plus 1 means 1. So in first one, we have only one orbital. Therefore, L is equal to 0 means M is equal to 0. And when L is equal to 0 and when M is equal to 0, we call it as S orbital. So S orbital is present in S sublevel or S subshell. And its capacity is only 2 electrons. So in S sublevel, we have 2 electrons. Now, the values, that is 2L plus 1, will be from minus M to plus M. Minus M, etc., etc., minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1, let us consider L is equal to 0. It has M is equal to 0 for value of M, and it represents S orbital. Second one, L is 1. When L is 1, M can have 2 into 1 plus 2, 3 values, and these values are minus 1, 0, 1. It is nothing but P orbital. And as I told you just now, we can have three, P sublevel will have three orbitals, namely Px, Py, and Pz. This is just like this, this picture. Actually, where from these are coming, as we discussed in last class, that when spectral lines are placed, they are passed through electric field or magnetic field, they split into further fine lines. Okay? If it is divided into three lines, it will be the picture. and these three lines will be like this, which are nothing but L is equal to 1. When L is equal to 1, M can have value 0, minus 1, plus 1. And these are nothing but P orbitals, 3 P orbitals, Px, Py, and Pz. And here, this is for L is equal to 2, where M can have 2 into 2, 4, plus 1, 5 values. And these values are M is equal to minus 2 to plus 2, means minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1, and 2. So this is the case with this figure will illustrate you the picture how when spectral line is passed through electric field or magnetic field, the orbitals will orient in different direction. Why this is happening? Because their energies are different, therefore they will be influenced by the electric field and our magnetic field up to different extent. Because they are not having same energy or equal energy, then the influence of electric field and magnetic field will be different. As a result, these orbitals will orient themselves into different directions. This is M is equal to 0. This is the case where L is 2, but the values of M are from minus 2 to plus 2. This is 0. This is minus 1, and this is minus 2, and this is plus 1. This is plus 2. In this way, we will have L is equal to means D sublevel, and we have 5 D orbitals. In D sublevel, there are 5 orbitals, and 5 D orbitals are DXY, DYZ, DZX, DX square minus Y square, and DZ square. In this way, we have 5 orbitals in D sublevel. Okay. Similarly, for L is equal to 3, formula is 2L plus 1, means 2 into 3, 6 plus 1, 7 orbitals in L is equal to 3 represent F sublevel. So in F sublevel, we have 7 orbitals, and the values or M is equal to minus 3 to plus 3, minus 3, minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, for M is, for M, and which gives you 7 orbitals. Therefore, we can say in F sublevel, we have 7 orbitals. And now what will be the capacity of F? Because it has 7 orbitals, every orbital will contain 2 electrons, 2 into 7, 14 electrons. Now this picture will give you a clear idea of number of suborbitals and orbitals and the number by which they are denoted. This is angular quantum number L. It has L. L has 0 value, or the value of L is 0, then only one orbital will be there, and it is M is equal to 0 means S orbital. In S sublevel, S orbital. P sublevel will have L is equal to 1, and totally 3 values for it. Those values are M is equal to minus 1, 0, plus 1, 3, P orbitals, Px, Py, and Pz. In this way, we discussed just now. So this was about magnetic quantum number. In next class, we will take spin quantum number and other things. So for today's class, this is the end. And in next class, we will continue the same chapter and other topics will be discussed. So for today, it is the end.